Hello viewer, you are watching Breath of Praise, and in this season we are focusing on the sanctuary, and the verse for this season is coming from the book of Psalms chapter 77 verse 13, which says, "Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary." And dear viewer, if you've not been watching, please go back to our YouTube page and watch the previous episodes, because we've laid a foundation of what the sanctuary is, why we have it, why we have that system, and we are trying to understand more and more about this sanctuary message. And today we are going to be talking about patterns. The title is actually According to the Pattern. We've established what the sanctuary is, and now we want to understand, you know, the pattern. We know that the sanctuary is a pattern of what is in heaven. So now we want to understand how all that works. So please stay with us as we start this episode. To start us off, let me start by introducing, then we'll have a word of prayer. Okay, so Steve, I'll start with Steve.
Hello viewer, once more we welcome you as we journey in this wonderful message that God has presented before us. Welcome.
God bless you, Steve. Thank you for being here. We have Enoch. Please say hello.
Welcome to today's study.
Thank you so much. And here we have Darius. He's no longer new. This is episode 3. He's good now. Karibu sana.
Hello viewer, welcome to this episode. Be blessed.
Amen. And here we have Justice. Justice Nyaga.
Hi friend, good to see you once again. Welcome.
Yes, thank you for being here. Today he's alone, but not entirely. She's somewhere here.
Yes, in the vicinity.
In the vicinity. His family is here. Karibu sana. And we have over here George Siage. Please say hello.
Hello, viewer.
Karibuni. And right next to me is my sister Helen. Please say hello.
Welcome, viewer. And we're glad that you're here.
Thank you. Thank you all. We are just here to discuss the word of God together and sing praises unto him. Amen?
Amen.
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 So before we begin, I'd like Steve to offer a word of prayer.
Tuombe. Baba unayetupenda, Mungu ishie juu mbinguni, asante sana kwa kutuleta pamoja tuweze kujadili neno lako. Ebu upate kufungua mawazo yetu ili yote tutakayo soma yawe ya kutukuza, na pia Mungu Baba ya kufanya tuenende kulingana na mapenzi yako. Ili ndilo ombi letu katika jina la Yesu tumeomba na kuamini. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Asante sana. Sasa Kiswahili imeishia hapo. We can continue, and before we start, we're going to sing the song "Oh Listen to a Wondrous Story." This is a story of who? Jesus.
And ourselves, how we were lost.
And how we were lost, and now, and how he saved us. Amen. Let's sing that song together. I'll invite Debbie to join us.
Who saved us from eternal
knows
that God's Son upon the cross
did
he died for you.
Where is he now?
Liveth thou in heaven interceding.
Will you surrender to the Savior? To his scepter humbly bow. You too shall come to know his favor. He will save you now. Who saved us from eternal loss?
But God's Son upon the cross.
Wonderful, powerful song. Who saved us from eternal loss? Upon the cross. What did he do?
He died for me.
For me.
And you.
Where is he now?
In heaven.
Interceding. And that's really what we are talking about. Because he is our high priest in heaven interceding for us. And now let's understand that. In the context of, you know, the sanctuary that he set up here on people are instructed to set up here on earth, and how it is in parallel with what is going on in heaven. So to start us off, maybe let's understand, how do we know that there's an actual parallel?
I think we get that from scripture. The book of Hebrews chapter 8, verse 1 to 5. Let me just quickly read 1 to 3. Now this is the main point of the things we are saying. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord erected and not man. And then 5 it says, who serves the copy and shadow of the heavenly things, as Moses was divinely instructed when he was about to make the tabernacle. For he said, see that you make all things according to the pattern shown you on the mountain. So basically what Moses was instructed to do in Exodus, that they construct a sanctuary, was a replica of what Christ is doing in heaven, as we've seen from the book of Hebrews chapter 8 from verse 1 to 6.
Wow. Well, let's do a very, very quick recap for the viewer who's watching this episode for the very first time. We talked about the sanctuary, right?
Yes.
In episode 1. Darius, what did we say is in this? Okay, you don't have to say in detail.
Okay.
But why is there a sanctuary?
The sanctuary is there for God to, because God said he wants us to build him for him a sanctuary.
Yes.
That he may have a place to dwell with us here.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then we looked at the patriarchs. And how they practiced the sacrificial system. We talked about, you know, different people, Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, Abraham, Noah, you know, and all. And now eventually we got to Moses now and the Israelites, when now they were instructed to build
a sanctuary.
And now we want to understand henceforth now how this applies to, you know, to us at the pattern. Thank you for elaborating on that, Steve. Does anyone else have something to add on patterns?
It is all about the story of salvation. And it's God who's trying to remind man, this is what I am doing so that I can redeem you. Because when sin entered, there was a crisis. And, you know, man would have been lost were it not for Jesus. But good enough, the plan of our salvation was not an afterthought. So by the time we're getting to Moses, the children of Israel have really forgotten that God is their savior. And God wanted to come and show them, you know, I really want to save humanity. So the sanctuary was a pattern. It was just a copy, something that is showing us what God is doing in heaven. So that if we look at a certain service in that sanctuary, we can actually
understand, get a clearer understanding of what God is doing in heaven. In essence, it's just like teaching with illustrations.
Yes. God is a good teacher.
He's the greatest teacher. Yes.
Okay, we can now start looking at the different services that occurred in the sanctuary and now how they are a parallel to the one in heaven. So who wants to start us off?
So we had two divisions of the ministry in the sanctuary, and I'll just read something. The administration of the sanctuary consisted of two divisions, a daily and a yearly service. So the daily service was performed at the altar of burnt offering in the court of the tabernacle and in the holy place. So we had the court and we had the holy place. And then the yearly service was performed in the most holy place once a year, and it was a special work done only by the high priest in the most holy place. And we'll discuss about it. It was the Day of Atonement. So those are the subdivisions.
Okay, so we have the daily and the yearly. Okay, so let's understand more about the daily. What would happen in the daily service?
And even probably before we get to the daily service and going to the detail, it's important to realize that even for Jesus himself, there was something that he was doing daily. And that's what we've sung. He is in heaven interceding. And ever since he went up to heaven, because when Jesus died, the priestly ministry was ended. The curtain was torn into two, and it shows now that they've moved into a different dispensation. So Jesus went into heaven and he was pleading for us until now, that time when he also went into the most holy place. So the daily services would happen, outer court and holy place. But the Day of Atonement, only once he would enter into the most holy once, and then after that it was once a year. In the similar fashion, Jesus also has entered into the most holy place, and he's continuing with the work of atonement, and we'll understand that more. So I think it's a good parallel to see now before we go to the daily.
I would like us to tie this to see why we are talking about Jesus as the priest. Hebrews chapter 5 from verse 1 right through to 9 gives us a context to this, through to verse 10 for your reference, viewer. You can go through there, but it tells us that Christ is actually a high priest higher than those who are ordained here below. It gives him a title, a priest of the order of Melchizedek. Meaning he has functions more than those priests that we had in the sacrificial system. Remember, back then we had a high priest who would officiate only once a year, and then you had the other priests who would officiate on the daily. But Christ took both of these, and even though he took both, he still served as the sacrifice. So he was both the sacrifice, the high priest, and the priest.
And did you say both the sacrifice?
Imagine. I don't know another word to take three words in that. But surely his duties were all encompassing. And as I've been saying, Christ's work is perfect and done wholly. And in him there's everything.
Everything.
Wow.
Hey, Yanni. You know, it's amazing. It's amazing how Jesus offered himself as the lamb. We are looking at the outer court, what would happen at the outer court. Jesus, the lamb represents Jesus. We talked about in the previous episode the lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. Then we go into the priestly ministry in the holy place. That's still Jesus. Most holy place. Jesus. This whole message is about Jesus. Jesus is our everything. Amen. Okay. Let us continue talking about the daily services. Enoch, I've not heard you, even Helen.
So for the daily services, these were sacrifices done every day, morning and evening, with the specifics given in the Bible as well. I think it's part of it is in, is it Numbers
28,
3 to 6? Now this were done for, since let's say we had two categories. We had the sin offering, we had the burnt offering, and many, we also have the others, the grain offering and all that. But what comes is that because human beings sin every other time, so the sins we do when we know, the sins we do when we actually didn't know even sinned, because our nature is sinful. So both these sins, once you realize that you've done some wrong thing, you quickly would go to the sanctuary and give the animal. Now the and the priest would do the work of after you've, remember we said it's you yourself that was laying your hand, transferring your sin to the animal figuratively, and then killing the animal, and then the priest offers it on your behalf. Yeah, so that's an introduction.
Yes, yes. Now let's look at the parallel.
Yeah.
Or that's what would happen. What did that signify?
Yeah, and it's true. There are two offerings. There's a burnt offering, and what he was describing is a sin offering, and you can get that in Leviticus 4. So there's a sin offering. If you commit sin, you take the animal that had been specified for a priest. It was a bull. Almost, and similar also to if it was a congregation, showing that the sin of a leader is weighty, is weightier. And there's also the burnt offering. Now the burnt offering, you can get that in I think it's good for the reader to the viewer to read with us, Numbers 28 verse 4, and this is what it says. The one lamb you shall offer in the morning, and the other lamb you shall offer in the evening. So I will just go back to verse 3, and you shall say to them, that is Numbers 28 verse 3, and you shall say to them, this is the offering made by fire which you shall offer to the Lord, two male lambs in their first year, without blemish, day by day as a regular burnt offering. So in essence, the priest will go in the morning, offers that burnt offering. That lamb is killed and the offering is offered. In the evening, the same is done. And this was to represent, number one, of course, that it was to show them that we need to daily depend on the merits of the blood of Jesus Christ, which cleanses our sin. Many other lessons you can learn about, of course, we were mentioning that, you know, as a husband, you're the priest, and you need to ensure you have daily worship in the evening and in the morning. And also, so that lamb was representing Jesus, whose blood daily covers us. And I think it's important to know that. And you realize it had to be without blemish. Showing that Jesus was sinless.
Wow.
A perfect sacrifice.
Wow. Moving on. So that's the sin offering that, you know.
The sin, there's a burnt offering.
Yes.
And then there's a sin offering. The same thing, the blood.
Yes.
Just pointing us to that blood had to be shed.
That's
the blood of the Messiah.
Yes.
So that we can be saved.
Yes.
And then the other service that would happen daily is altar of incense.
Yes. Can someone talk about justice? Thank you so much.
<You're welcome. laughs> Maybe I'd love to add to that. There was that act of placing the hand. The sinner who offered the sacrifice placed his hand. So that's a demonstration of the transfer of sin. And that's why in John, when he saw Jesus come, he proclaimed, behold, the lamb that taketh away the sin. Not sins. Sin of what? The world. And you know, sin is transgression of the law. So it's symbolic. Christ came to take away the sin of the world, just in the same manner that the repentant sinner took a lamb and placed his hands. So that demonstrated the act of transferring sin from the sinner to the substitute, which was the lamb.
Which is confession, actually.
Confession.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
First John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just
to forgive us.
Yeah, to forgive us and to cleanse us from
all unrighteousness.
Yes.
Helen, I've not heard your voice.
I would like to read from Hebrews 9, verse 11. But Christ came as high priest of the good things to come, with a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation. Also 12, that says, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood. He entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. And then 13, lastly, for if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh. So you see, the other amazing thing is in these sacrifices they had to happen daily because a lamb was not sufficient to clean all. So anytime I sin, I'd have to go and and sacrifice a lamb. But Christ died on the cross once, and that blood is sufficient to wash away all our sins.
Oh wow, that's a very a very important parallel. You talked about now when going to the holy place, there were there would be sprinkling
incense,
the burning of the incense that would happen on a daily as well.
Daily basis.
And what would that signify?
The first is to direct the viewer to Exodus 30:34, because this is not our making, it is in scripture. So it talks about the incense. Exodus 30:34.
Now I'd like us to understand a little bit more about now, you know, when we started this season, George was telling us how this is the movement of sin. You know, and there's a way now, how the sin, how Christ forgives us, you know, rather the cancellation of the sin, the recording. I'd like to us to understand about that and how it would happen and the parallels around it. Before, hey, we don't have much time, but we'll continue.
Be done in even a second.
Thank you, Justin.
Yeah, so number one, the cancellation of sin, as Steve has mentioned, a sinner will come, I've committed sin. I feel like I need this sin to be gotten. It's sticky. So I come, I pray and confess my sins on that animal, and then the moment that has happened, the blood is you know, is slaughtered, the blood is sprinkled at the curtain in the holy holy place, and that shows the transfer of sins from myself, and I walk away justified. I walk away feeling that I've been forgiven. So that's basically it. And something important that we need to remember, anytime, you know, even as that was happening, the incense, as it was going up, it was mingled with the prayers of the people, showing that our prayers, even as we are praying, it's important to pray in the name of Jesus Christ, because only his righteousness makes our prayers acceptable. So that was it. And in the parallel in heaven, anytime we commit sin, there's a record of sin. Our sins are recorded. But if we pray, we are forgiven. But those sins, where are they? They're still in the sanctuary, waiting for them to be removed.
And that we'll understand in a bit. Dear viewer, do not change that channel, because we need to come back and talk about now the atonement. We've talked about the daily sacrifices. We need to understand the yearly, the yearly sacrifices that would happen. So do not change that channel. We'll be back. Everyone enjoying Breath of Praise. Welcome back, dear viewer. Thank you for tuning in and staying with us. You are still watching Breath of Praise, and we are talking about the sanctuary. Particularly today, we are discussing the parallels. We realize that the sanctuary that was instructed to be built, or rather constructed here on earth, is a parallel of the one in heaven.
Made by God.
Not man. So we'd like to understand more and more about that. And before we do, let's sing this beautiful hymn 415, Christ the Lord, all power possessing. Let's sing that song together. I'll invite Debbie to join us.
Christ the Lord, all power possessing, parting mounted heaven's height, gracious hands outstretched in blessings, clouds received is from their sight. Christ ascended, Christ ascended, Christ ascended on the thank you.
I feel like Christ was actually coming on the clouds. Let's take our seats. This is basically the summary of what we are talking about.
Yes, yes, yes.
And in fact, now in this part of the discussion, we're going to understand it even more. What Christ is doing in heaven at the moment for us.
Yes.
So let's go into the most holy place. Who wants to start?
I think the picking point will be from that song.
Okay.
If you look at stanza 2, he's saying the Father is seated and on his throne, and Christ is coming on the clouds. So there are two times that in the Bible we see that illustrated. And let's go to Daniel chapter 7. And in Daniel chapter 7, there's something that is playing out. And what is playing out is Jesus has been doing the work like of the daily services that had been doing, we saw in the, that is praying for us, his mediatorial work, he's just interceding for us. But now there is something that is happening when you look at Daniel chapter 7 and verse 9 says, I watched till the thrones were put in place, and the Ancient of Days, that's what we sang about in stanza 2, was seated. His garments was white as snow, and his hair, the hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels a burning fire. And then after that, down into verse 10, it says, the court was seated and the books were opened. And then you go to verse 13, I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom. In essence, this is a depiction of what happened when Christ was moving from the holy place into the most holy place.
Yes.
So, but before we get to that, we really need to come back down.
Yes.
So that we discuss those parallels, because he is a high priest. Yes. He is the original. These were photocopies. So we need to see what was happening. In essence, this is a day of atonement that was beginning in heaven, and we are still till that point. But let's look at the
parallels.
The illustration, demonstration, so that we get to understand clearly.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, we had mentioned, you'd asked about the movement of sin. Let's recap that, and maybe it will help us understand the flow. Right from the beginning, when you brought your sin offering, it was slaughtered at the altar, right? And the blood, remember we discussed and found out that it is the blood that cleanses, and it is also the one that now holds the sin, because it held the life of the animal, and now the blood has the sin. Sin is sticky. We'll keep saying that. So now the sin is in the blood. And then when you read Leviticus chapter 4 verses 6, it tells us where the blood goes next. And the priest shall dip his finger in the blood and sprinkle the blood seven times before the Lord, before the veil in the sanctuary. Which veil? Remember we talked of a veil. There's only one veil, and it's partitioning the holy place and the most holy place. Yeah. So remember, every sin ended at this veil. So what we are going to discuss next will show us what happened, because it's like the sin is staining the sanctuary. And that's why the sanctuary is getting to a point where it needs to be cleansed. The next service we are talking about, the next parallel, deals with this sin that has accumulated in the sanctuary. This is where the sin has been.
Yes. Darius, Enoch. Oh, I thought I saw someone. Yes, what would you like to say now? We're getting into the most, we're now in the most holy place. What actually happens there and what are the parallels?
Okay, so now we turn to the book of Leviticus chapter 16, where it talks about actually what used to happen in the Day of Atonement. And there were several sacrifices offered upon the Day of Atonement. And the chief service of the day was the offering of goats. So two goats were brought to the door of the sanctuary, where lots were cast upon them, one for the Lord and another one was a scapegoat. Yeah, so we had two goats which were brought by the congregation, and then one of the goats would be used for the burnt offering, if I'm right. Yeah, the goat was for the burnt offering, and then the burnt offering would be done. And then now, the high priest killed the Lord's goat, and then clad in his gorgeous robes, he passed with the blood of the goat into the most holy place. Yeah, so just as he entered within the second veil, carrying the golden censer filled with coals of fire from the altar before the Lord, and his hand full of incense, he placed the incense upon the coals in the censer, that the cloud of fragrant incense might cover him as he passed in before the visible presence of God, as manifested between the cherubim above the mercy seat. We know God, the presence of God was in between those two cherubim, between above the mercy seat. So as he passed, he then, with his fingers, he sprinkled the blood upon the mercy seat, above the broken law of God. Then going out into the first apartment, he touched the horns of the golden altar with the blood. So now we see where the sin has been transferred. Yeah. He came with the sin from the outer court, because he had slain the goat, and then he sprinkled the sin on the mercy seat, and also on the horns of the golden altar.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's a lot. Enoch,
maybe just to do a quick recap from down again. The priest was also a sinner. So if you read Leviticus 16 verses 3, he had to first offer for himself. And then is when he's going to do this, whatever Darius has put to us. There are special things to note. We need to know the two goats. The viewer, we need you to know about the scapegoat and the Lord's, the one that is going to be transferred to, and the one that is going to be slain, so that the blood is used as Darius has put. So let's remember, the priest was also a sinner and had to perform for him and his family.
Probably because he was representing Jesus, who was sinless.
He also had to be sinless.
At that time he had to be sinless.
And right there, there's another parallel. You see, there's the Lord's goat and there's Azazel, the goat of Azazel, or the scapegoat. Now, the Lord's goat is slaughtered. Watch what happens to its blood. It goes right to the mercy seat. It is because of Christ's blood that we have mercy, and we are redeemed from our sin. And that's why it goes right, it doesn't stop at the veil. It goes right to the mercy seat. In the presence of God, it is God recognizes Christ's blood only. You see? And that's why we are redeemed. Now we need to see what happens to Azazel, because this represents a different character entirely.
Wow, this is this is a whole story. Steve, Helen, do you have anything to say?
I wanted to add, just as it has been captured in the book of Hebrews 9:12, that Christ, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place. So this happened on Calvary. Upon his sacrifice, now he went to heaven to
administers his mercies to all those who believe. So remember, he came, died because he was sent as the only begotten Son, pure, undefiled. So the act of him now ministering, just as the priest upon offering his sacrifice now moved to the Holy of Holies, it is in the same manner that upon Christ's sacrifice, which ought not to be repeated again, it was once and for all, that now he went to minister to us in the heavenly sanctuary.
Helen, what are you getting from this whole discussion? Or what would you like to add?
What I'd love to read Leviticus 16. I'd want us to look at the animals that were there, because as was it was rightly pointed,
we need
there
to were, understand.
Yes. So 16 verses 3. Thus Aaron shall come into the holy place with the blood of a young bull as a sin offering and of a ram as a burnt offering. So it's good to note that still on this day there was still a sin offering that was to be offered and a burnt offering. And then we can go to verse 6, where it says, Aaron shall offer the bull as a sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house. And then he shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. So just as it was said, Aaron had to go and first kill the bull and atone for his sins, and then atone for the sins of everyone.
Thank you, Enoch.
Maybe another pointer in the same environment. During this day, there was no one.
There was
no one at the tabernacle when all this process was happening, except the priest.
So we
should
the high priest.
We should take note of that. It's in Leviticus 16:17. And the other aspect is that this scapegoat, I know there's a confusion. When we transfer the our sin and the first goat, the Lord's goat is sacrificed. This other one, we put your hands again, but this one is sent away. I think we need to understand that. Yeah.
What are the parallels?
Yes.
Justice.
So parallel number one, look, if you're to wash, if you're to mop a floor, you don't mop and then you go stepping on where you've
yes.
the other way around. So Jesus, because the sins have been transferred to the holy place and then now to the most holy place. Then the work of atonement. What is atonement? To make reparations for a wrong that has been done. God's law is holy. So it called for something that is as holy as that to make atonement for the wrong that had been done. Only the blood of Jesus would atone. And then justice is satisfied. Justice and mercy kiss. And then once that happens, then the record of sin is expunged. So for everyone who's believed in Jesus and has lived a righteous life, then behind their name, beside their name is written
pardoned.
Because of the blood of Jesus. And then that whole sin, now you realize everybody has to pay for their what they do. If you do good, there is a reward. Jesus is coming with a reward. If you do wrong, there is also a punishment. So that all, because Satan is the originator of sin, what happens? That everyone he has caused to sin, it will also be attributed back to him, and he has to pay for his own sin. He's not paying for our sin, he's paying for his own sin, but for the magnitude of all that he has caused to lead astray. And the most important parallel, I think, for me is that number one, Jesus is our high priest. And he goes into the most holy place to do the work of atonement. What is the work of atonement? Is the work of judgment. Because we said the sins are transferred into the heavenly sanctuary. And how are they transferred? There is a record. When you read Ecclesiastes 12 verse 14, there's a record of sin. And Matthew chapter 12 verse 36 and 37 in your own time, there's a record of sin. And there's another book which is called the Book of Remembrance. And another one which is, you can find that in Psalms chapter 56 verse 8. And then there's a Book of Life. And the Book of Life, Luke 10 verse 20, rejoice that your names are written in the Book of Life. Everyone who's accepted Jesus. So how does the work of judgment happen? We look into, but in essence, there are atonement is a work of judgment that Jesus is doing, but his blood cleanses us and makes us free from the penalty of sin, which is the second death.
Yeah. Amen.
Dear viewer, time is gone. But do not worry. The next episode, we will expound more. So please keep watching Breath of Praise, because we really need to understand what Christ is doing at the moment for us and what we need to be doing just in response to his love for us. Mm. So let's sing the song Wamwendea Yesu as we close this episode. The blood, that Jesus shed is enough to wash away all our sins. And we have seen in the sacrificial system, that is what Jesus is doing. He's redeeming us. And so I pray that you have learned something today. Please tune in next week so that we can continue understanding and learning more about the sanctuary, which is about Jesus Christ. God bless you. See you next week.
Kuoshwa kwa damu itutakasayo.